from TréLiz, and I'm really, really excited today because I held a giveaway on Instagram, and I'm very happy that you responded so well. So the game was for you to question me with whatever you wanted, and I will be answering. And there's gonna be two winners with two skeins of whichever colorway you would like in my Zeus yarn base, which is my 100% superwash merino single fingering weight. So I'm very excited. I had the idea to do to answer, you know, each question to a different setting and etc. But today is the giveaway expiring day, and I wanted to launch the video the same day that I would say who the winner is, and it kind of felt a bit, you know, out of time. Really fun for me to do, you know, a little collage of many videos, but I didn't really have the time to do it, so I'm sorry if you're you know, if you're disappointed by that. So here we go. Should I take the big plunge? Okay, so here today I'm in my Fabry yarn room of the house. It's a bit of a mess, if you could just see, you know, on the ground or from the other side, but it's a really sunny day. There's a bit of a northern wind, which is a bit frisky, but it's really nice with the sun. And I have also the company of my dog, which I will show her because she has to say hi. And just before I start, I figure out I should show you what I'm wearing, which is my building blocks. You've already seen it, but what you've not seen is the sweater I'm wearing. This sweater is actually a Drangy sweater by Stephen West that I knitted 2 years ago for my boyfriend. And it's the only garment I knitted him, but I knitted it in the summertime and I measured him in the summertime where he's working his ass off, like 14 hours per day, and he's thin and nice, but in the winter time he's getting weight and it didn't fit him. But I really liked it, and even though it had a bit of a hole over here, we fixed it and it shows a bit, you can see it, but it's okay, like for the house, or you know, just to have something warm to run errands and stuff like that. I really like it, and I really love the colors, and the yarn is very soft and nice. And I think it was in the really beginnings that I started knitting, and I think this is my Labrigo. Don't ask me the colors, but I think I've put it on Ravelry, so yeah, there's a possibility I have it on Ravelry. But I really, really like it, even though if it has this little problem over here, but I don't care. I like it, it's warm, and it's really, really cozy. So now we can start, I think. Actually, I've written your questions on my notebook, and this is one of my favorite notebooks. I've put splashes of colors in the pages. I think I've already shown it to you, but okay, I can show it again. So are you ready? There's a lot of them, so I hope I'm not really gonna get tired, but and if I am, I'm gonna totally take a break, okay? So I should start. So the first question is, which of your beauties is your favorite yarn base and color? So for a very long time, my One of my favorites were Apollon and Hermes. Apollon is a yarn base of 50% superwash merino, 50% silk, and Hermes is the softest, beautiful 70% baby alpaca, 20% silk, and 10% cashmere. And the cashmere makes the difference. And you know, a lot of people don't like baby alpaca because they found that it comes very heavy. But this yarn, believe me, it has the most beautiful drape. I have two sweaters. My Zenith sweater and my Boxy sweater are in this beautiful Hermes yarn base, and I love them both. They're very soft, very warm, very squishy, and the drapes feel very airy, and I really really like it. My Apollon yarn base, the one with the silk, I really like it because I like the shimmering of silk, and I think it makes it very luxurious and very elegant, you know, and it's really nice. I really love it. But now one of my new yarn bases that I'm totally in love with is the NYX yarn base, which is MCN, Merino Nylon Cashmere. Actually, I don't care for a nylon, but in this blend, you don't feel it. I think it's the cashmere that takes and conquers the yarn base, and it's dreamy soft. I'm knitting my Chasseur Shrug now with it, and I love it. It's amazing. It's very soft. And now that I've started knitting socks, I think I'm gonna totally use that one. And I also added to the shop two yarn bases that are coming up soon. Actually, I think tomorrow there's gonna be the first pre-orders of those. Eros, which is a single stellina, and the Psyche. I think it's gonna be difficult to pronounce in English, Psyche, which is Eros' girlfriend in mythology. And it's a single with silk, and they both are amazingly beautiful, but again, Psyche with the silk is going to another level for me. The colorway, my favorite colorway, I really adored for a very long time. For a very, very long time. I'm not sure if I have it over here to show it to you. Yes. This is my Amolite colorway, my Ares, my sock yarn. And I really love the purple and the little turquoise greenish here in an overall yellowish, a bit orangey yarn. And I really love this yarn for a lot, this colorway. And I, of course, love my Pollock colorway and my Charlotte colorway, and I don't know, I have so many that I adore. I love Middle Finger, which is a black with a bold green neon, and I love it. And I don't know, and Beach Slop and Supergirl, and yeah, I love most of my colorways, so I guess that's a good thing, right? Where do you get your inspiration for the colorways from? I think everywhere. And what I used to say is, whatever makes my soul sing is inspirational. And that can be anything. It can be a place, it can be a movie, it can be a book, it can be a character, it can be a garment. You know, you just see something and you want to just do it. You picture it like in these colors and you just have to do it. Yeah, I don't know. I like so many things, and I think I can find inspiration in most things. And I think that's one of the reasons why my my colorways have names of movies, have names of I don't know, a bit more revolutionary names like focaccino or like middle finger or like beach slap or like weird is rad, because there are things that speak to me and that I want to be, and you know, and for example the chakras, it's my yogi inspired colorways. I think whatever really can touch me and that I like can be an inspiration. It can be a picture of a sunset, it can be a picture of stones, of crystals, like anything. Favorite food, and if it inspires you to new colors. So this question is from Marie-Louise in Switzerland. Hi Marie-Louise, how are you? So when I was a kid, I used to always answer that question with either roasted chicken with potatoes in the oven, you know, or pasta or pizza or something, you know, that kids adore. But I think now it's just one thing. It comes all to the potato. Yeah, potato. Either in the oven, either fried, either, I don't know, all the way, dauphinois, or I'm a sucker for potato and butter, yeah. And I'm gonna be fat one day with lots of cholesterol, but hopefully I would be too old to notice and to care about. But yeah, I really love potatoes. And it's funny because I don't know if they can really inspire me for a colorway, but there are a lot of varieties. There are red potatoes, purple potatoes, you know. But when I eat something that I really like I'm taking it and I'm closing my mouth and it's like a dream. So they haven't really inspired me to dye something, but I'm sure I'm gonna have fireworks someday with my potato eating, and I don't know yet, but I love a good potato, yum. It's silly, but yeah. Okay, I love pasta, I love making bread, I love homemade bread, otherwise I don't really care for it. I love... I love noodles, you know, all the pad thais and things like that. I love sushi. But yeah, but like the potato, there's nothing. I think for me, it's the more sexy food that you can have, because however you made it, it's wonderful. Okay. Are you super excited you've won the Y'all giveaway? That's by Anne. Yes, I'm super excited. I'm crazy about it. I can't believe it, actually. And it's been a few days that, actually a week that it was announced that I won. And I'm freaking out with it, because actually I saw the giveaway and I usually don't, because I have so much yarn, I don't participate in giveaways. Like I might tag people, but I don't really do it that much to win, but more to share the information and, you know, to have more people come, because that's the point of a giveaway. I've done a lot of them and I'm very happy when it's a successful giveaway, of course. And so when I saw Stephen West's picture, I was like, I tagged some friends and then I was, she asks to repost. Should I repost? Well, maybe other people need more of the yarn. And but I say, yeah, but it's fun. So it's a yarn along. You're a yarn addict. So, okay, I said I'm gonna repost it. And I did. And of course, I dismissed it. It was something that it was done. And last week, after my meditation course and my yoga course, I'm very, you know, relaxed and happy. And looking on my phone after 4 or 5 hours, which is something rare, I see notifications with congratulations, TréLiz, and oh, that's so great, I'm so happy you won it. And I'm like, what happened? why did they congratulate me? Did I had a giveaway? Well, I should be giving things. You know, and I was like a bit confused. I didn't really realize what was happening. And then I see the notification of Stephen West's post that I won. And I was like, oh my God, I won, really, what's happening? So it was so funny because I'm doing this, I'm taking this yoga class with the friend that we learn knitting together. And she looked at me and she was like, what's happening? Why are you so excited? And I'm like, I won Stephen West's giveaway. We're like, ah, yeah! And it was so crazy. And I wanted to take a video of me, to put it on Instagram, to say thank you. But I was so excited that I was so jumpy when I was driving my car that I said, okay, I'm not gonna cause an accident from happiness. Like, just go home, be safe, and then you send something. So it was really cool. It is really cool. And I really can't wait to see what I'm getting. Actually, I was kind of stressed that, my God, there's things coming up my way and I should finish my knitting. And you know, that days I was procrastinating. So it really gave me also a funk to get on with my knitting. So it's amazing. Yeah, I really, really enjoy it. I'm super excited. And also I'm having yarn from from dyers that I haven't really tried and that I hear a lot of talking about, that I follow, that have a lot of respect for them, and I'm so happy, really happy about it. What inspires you the most in dyeing yarn? What I love is that the color combinations are endless, and what I even more like is that a colorway is never gonna seem the same. You can have different variations even the same day, the same lot, but I'm not talking about that. I'm talking that a different yarn base is gonna take differently the color, the dye. And I absolutely love it because it is the character of the yarn that gives breath and essence and life to the colors and not the other way around. And I know there are some dyers that they really want and they achieve some of them, you know, by putting more dye in some yarn bases than others and by changing the amounts and everything to have a very nice copy of the same colorway in different yarn bases. But I don't agree with that. I love my recipe to be the same for all yarn bases and to really have the characteristic of the fiber shown in that colorway. So for example, a single is going to be very vibrant and more vibrant than a yarn with 50% merino, 50% cotton, for example. Or silk is more difficult to take up the dye, but once it takes it up, it's really vibrant and luscious, and I like that. I don't mind the difference, and I actually love it. I think it gives more in the uniqueness, and I love that. If you could do a fairy tale themed yarn, what would it be? When I hear the word fairy tale, the Little Riding Hood is always popping into my mind, and then Snow White, but they're not my favorite fairy tales. And my favorite fairy tale is actually a very creepy one, and one that I was kind of scared of at school. I remember in primary school they told us this fairy tale, and it's the fairy tale of Bluebird. I love this fairy tale, and it kind of gives me, you know, the sense that, you know, you can be curious about things, but you have to have the knowledge when to be ready about the knowledge that you're gonna get after you're curious, you know. It's because sometimes we are having knowledge that we're not ready to handle, and that's not good. and you can end up in trouble. So I don't know, I really like this creepy tale. And I also love another tale, which is actually written in a book called Running Bulls, The Woman Who Runs with the Bulls, by Clarissa Pincola Estes. I love her, and actually in this book she has lots of fairy tales, and she explains it from the side of the psychologist and what it means and what it stands for, and it's really interesting, and I love this book. And there's a fairy tale in that book that's called The Skeleton Woman, and it's really amazing and really a beautiful story. So yeah, that's a question from Eleni Manacori, who does beautiful project bags. What is your favorite knitted garment? So my favorite knitted garment, and it's one of the most the fastest ones that I've knit so far, is the Manzanilla sweater from Jorge Locatelli. And I've actually reconsidered of doing a second one, but with the longer sleeves. And that's kind of weird for me, because I hate sleeves because they're two. So imagine doing the same pattern for the second time. But I really like it, and I really loved it. And actually the construction helps a lot, because you start with the sleeves and then with the body. So when you realize that you've done the sleeves, then it's just go, and bam, it's ready. It's amazing. It's an amazing pattern. Then Meredith Buzzeria Designs asked me, if it could be an animal, which one? Like, come on, Meredith, you know me. I love all animals. It's like, if I could be an animal, I could be all of them. Like, literally all of them. But if I have to choose, I think it would be a big cat, like a lion or a tiger. I think something like that. I love horses also, but I wouldn't like to be a horse. That's kind of weird maybe, but, and I don't know what does that mean for me, but I would like to be a big cat. Yeah. Favorite colorways and why? Well, I told you that I really like most of my colorways. There are very few that, and it's not that I dislike them, it's just maybe like a plain, you know, a semi-solid isn't that exciting as a true variegated, which I'm crazy about them. But yeah, I love all of my colorways, most of them. I don't really have a favorite one, but this time I'm gonna use a lot Pollock. I really like it, Pollock. Elise is asking me, how did you learn French? So they didn't really ask me. My mom is half French, and me and my sister went to French school. We finished French school, so we always talked French. And it's just that now at home we speak more Greek, so I don't have so much practice, and I don't read that much of French books that I used to do. But I had a really good French classical education. Yeah, so I speak French. Kelly de Hilo asked me, do you speak Spanish? I will try to answer that in Spanish, and then I will tell you what I said. So, hablo un poquito de español. No me le recuerdo, pero no tengo mucha, no lo practicarlo mucho, pero comprendo muy bien. Y and that's it. So I said, I actually had Spanish in school. I really understand it very well when people talk to me and to read Spanish. But I didn't have enough practice the last years, so I kind of forgot it. I'm not that fluent anymore. I forgot my vocabulary. The good thing is that because I talk several languages, like if I go back to Spain for a couple of days, I will, you know, take it up very quickly. But that's it. I speak, but very, very slowly at this moment. I need to practice. Oh, Life in Wool asks me, what do you like so hard, the orange color? Does it remind you something in particular? It doesn't remind me something of particular, okay, maybe except sunrises and, you know, nice, I don't think, exotic places, I don't know why. But I think the thing that I love most about the orange color is that when I see a spectrum of colors, the one that brightens up all the others for me is not yellow, because yellow can be very horrific also for me, but which I love yellow also, but orange, because it's a hue between red and yellow, it takes all the warmth, and I like that about orange. I think I'm a happy person, and even if I'm not a happy person, I'm a very smiling person. Actually, at school, I was punished by a teacher, and he told me to write an essay, why am I smiling all the time? And so in that essay, I just wrote in one paragraph, he wanted two pages, I wrote one paragraph, and I said, I want to be happy, I want other people to be happy, so I'm smiling, and that's it. Like, if you don't like it, if I'm smiling, just don't look at me. And that was when I was 15 years old, and I think, yeah, that's kind of sums up my philosophy about life. And even if I'm sad, I want to be happy, and orange does and express that feeling for me. Red is too passionate. Yellow is too egocentric for me. It's like I'm the sun and you're around me. But orange is there in the middle, and it has something of both. It's a warm ball of beautiful. Yeah. So I'm happy with orange. La Martinozzo asks me why I don't do a podcast in French. Well, the reason is that my biggest fear of all, even if I don't look at it, I'm kind of shy, and I'm kind of shy, and I hate to think that people are bored with me. So making a podcast in English and in French seems a bit like I'm over the moon and over the place, and you have to listen to me and the English speaking and the French speaking people. So yeah, I don't know how I feel about it. And I also don't want to say the same things, and I will have to say the same things. And even if I don't say the same things, I will think, oh shit, sorry. I said that in the English podcast, but I didn't say it in the French podcast. And I don't know, maybe sometimes what I'm thinking is making smaller ones, maybe in French, like having, you know, some things, but I really don't know how I could work it around. I'm thinking actually to having this podcast with all the questions also in French, but I'm also not nearly at the first page still of the questions, and it's been 30 minutes that I'm talking, and I feel already my voice closing down, so, you know, and it's a lot of work, and, like, I don't always have the time, but that's a silly answer, and I don't want to say the time as an excuse, it's just, like, I don't want to bore you, but maybe if you're asking it for it, I'm not boring you, I'm just so great that you want me in all the languages. No, I'm just kidding, but, yeah, it's tiring also. So I will try to make it work, but I can't promise anything. I'm sorry. It's not at all that I'm snobbish about French or Greek. It nothing at all with it. Okay. Charlotte, which I know very well from France, asks me, what am I capable of doing for a lemon pie piece from La Cabane Tricotée? So, La Cabane Tricotée is a French local yarn store that I'm going, that will have a great collaboration with the owner, Cécile, and she's making this amazing lemon pie. Like, you can't imagine how great it is. Like, I'm eating the first bite, and from how much I love it, like, my eyes are rolling like crazy inside my head. So I'm always fantasizing, and when we're texting, everyone is like, Liz, how are you? And I'm always saying, oh, I'm thinking about the lemon pie. And you know, now they're making fun of me that I'm over obsessed about this cake. So what am I capable of doing? Well, I'm capable of coming there to eat a piece and then just go back home. But I will return the questions to Charlotte and I will ask her if she wants to. Well, I've done a lot of truth and dare when I was young, and what would be with one more? So you can come up with something and dare me to do it, and we can film it and put it up if you want. Oh my god, she's a creative one. What genres of book do you gravitate towards, and what would you recommend in that genre? So, when it comes to music, books, films, I like everything, like most of things. So, I like inspector, policy, detective ones. I like a romance or a story that's a setting in a historical place or whatever. I like science fiction. I also like a story where there's knitting, like for example the Friday Night Knitting Club. So I've gathered some that I really like. So here, the Friday Night Knitting Club. One of the thrillers that I really liked, and that was a kind of weird, but I liked it. It was Tokyo from Mo Hyder. Then recently, because Muriel from France, she gave me this. In English, it's The Rook. It's actually, I wouldn't say something extraordinary, but really nice and really cool to read, The Rook from Daniel O'Malley. Then I really love an inspector, and that's the Inspector Chen from Qiu Xiaolong. It's funny, but I have the collection in French and I really like him. And there's a collection of them, but you can read them separately, there's no problem. So Qiu Xiaolong, very nice author. It's funny because my books are much more English, but now I just picked some up and I have French ones. One that I adored, and I bought in 2011 in Geneva, because I like to put where I took my books from, it's Le Caveau de Famille. It's a Swedish roman story from Katarina Mazzetti. So I'm sure if it's translated in French, it's gonna be translated in English as well. I'm not sure about the original title, but it's really, really, really nice. Oh. Well, the original title is from, it's in Swedish, so it's Familjegraven. So I don't know if that helps. But if you put Caterina Mazzetti, I think you're gonna find all her books inside. And then I also really much enjoy science fiction, but like Lord of the Rings, of course. Well, I grew up, the summers we went to my mom's family in France, and my youngest uncles, we have like 5 years of difference. So, whenever they were babysitting us, they were all about play rolling and Lord of the Rings and geeky stuff, Star Wars and all this. So, from a very young age, I loved The Hobbit, I loved Lord of the Rings. I knew already about the Book of Ice and Fire. It's the books of Game of Thrones series that I knew all about them since I was very young. And The Princess Bride, this kind of stuff. Histories about vampires and stuff like that. So I really kind of like these kind of things, but it will depend also the mood. It's not that like I would love all vampire stories. Most of them might cross to me like as silly, but not all of them. And it will depend the mood that I'm in, okay? Because like for example, this winter we had a lot of family issues with health and things like that, so I wanted something that was easygoing and more happy. So I was gifted actually this book, The Book of Life, and they didn't actually so, but it's called All Souls Trilogy, and actually that book is the third one. So I had to go and take the first one, which is A Discovery of Witches, it's called, and it's really nice. I loved it. I'm at the second book. I kind of felt tired a bit, but now I'm back on track with it, and it's okay. And also, I have a big love. I told you that I love thrillers, but I'm not the kind of girl that I love whatever's scaring. I kind of love what's a bit more psychologically scary. Or like that it has something that you have to imagine. You don't really know what happens, but there's a hint. One of those books was actually also Tokyo was like that I showed you. And there's a book, there are actually four books that Stephen King wrote under the name Bachman. And actually this book has the four books in one, and it's called the Bachman books. But inside over here there's one book story which his name is The Long Walk. And as a teenager I had that book a separate and I read about it. And it wasn't scary at all, and well, it was kind of scary because you were in a long walk, and if your pace was getting down of a speed, they were going to shoot you. So yes, it was a bit scary, but the end is just so unpredictable. Like you think, okay, everyone's gonna die and one will win. But I really like the end, like, who could win after having experienced that? So it's really nice, and it's one of my favorite books growing up. And of course, I love yogic books. The one that I'm reading right now is The Inner Engineering, A Yogi's Guide to Joy. From Sadhguru. I love Sadhguru. You can watch also his videos on YouTube, and I love him because he speaks very simple and he speaks with examples, and he likes understands you. Like I'm a guy too. I'm not a big guru or whatever. Like of course he is, but he's very grounded and very real in what he says, and you can relate to him, and I really like that. So, but the book that has changed a lot of my perceptions and that adore, adore, adore And as you can see, it's been worn out. It's Woman Who Run With The Wolves from Clarissa Pinkola Estes. And I love this book. I love it. I think every woman and man, but all women should read it. It's amazing. I wish actually there was a similar one for guys, and I don't know if there would be, but to read it, and I really love it. I really love it. She writes different fairy tales that we already know, and she demystifies it. She is tearing apart the fairy tale, and it, she says about the symbolism of the fairy tale, about the psychic ideas behind the fairy tale and the personalities, and it's really great book. I love it. Which month of the year is more inspired for you to dye yarns? I would say that there's not a specific month, but I'm sure more definitely comfortable when it's spring or autumn, because the heat is not so high as in summer, and I hate when it's winter and I have to be, you know, all with my big cardigan and be dying with the pots and with the yarn and the water. So I'm mostly more inspired when I'm comfortable, and I'd say I'm more comfortable in the more spring and autumn months. What's the best cure for the hiccups? So, well, my mom would have said to scare the person who has the hiccups, and she did that wonderfully. Like, mom, if you're seeing that, like, seriously, you're the best. I totally remember once I was coming back from school and I had the hiccups, and she looks at me and she tells me they called today from school, and I was like, why did they didn't have to call you? Like, I was perfectly fine, but until like this guy told me this, and then the music teacher had to say that and that, and so she threw me out of class. And then, you know, she turns and she tells me, oh, your hiccups are gone. And I'm like, no, come on. Like, I literally told her everything without any reason to tell her anything. But she was really cool. She didn't say to me anything about what happened at school or why did you do that. Like, I think I punished myself just by, you know, writing myself out. Yeah, so that's one very effective way. And another effective way is, I think, to hold your breath and try to swallow multiple times. And yeah, it works. It works for me sometimes. Then, how did I learn to dye? Well, by reading, by experimenting, by watching videos, by doing. Yeah, I think I'm an experimental dyer. And then last year I did the Natalie Redding method of dyeing, but it's mostly about fibers. It's not dyeing yarn, but yeah, and it's not the same. A lot of people would think it's the same, but it's not. Dyeing raw wool can be very different, and it is. And I learned a lot about breeding. So now I do have also, you know, like a license or a paper to show that I'm doing or dying. But I learned by experimenting. I'm an experimental dyer. Which stage of the dyeing process do you prefer? Well, the dyeing process. Like putting the colors in the pots, especially when it's new colorways and you really don't know what's gonna happen. Magic, magic. magic is gonna happen. Yeah, colors, power. So yeah, the of course for me the most interesting part is when the color hits the yarn. Celine asks me that she would like to know everything about my encounter with yoga. Oof, that's gonna be a long story, my encounter with yoga. Well, I had a few years back an injury, a head injury, and from the very energetic person doing lots of athletic things, I couldn't do anything. So then when I started to be able to do those things, I couldn't because I was too weak. So I had to do something more restorative, but I hate gyms. And so I tried Pilates, I didn't like it at all. I tried a yoga class, but it was very westernized, like, you know, taking a pose and then doing another. And then I had my friend, which actually is the friend that we learned knitting together. And she was taking a class to this yoga studio, which was amazing. It was an amazing experience. They were chanting mantras all the way through the course. And it was really, really more like a spiritual practice as well. So I really liked that. It was another feeling. Something clicked. At the time we were also taking, both of us, a seminar about the healing properties of the chakras. So I was in a place where I wanted to learn a lot of things about myself, because the way that I hit my head, it was by sleepwalking. So that triggered a lot of questions. I knew that I was a sleepwalker, but it was the second time injuring myself. So there were a lot of questions that maybe something else was, and it wasn't just sleepwalking, but finally it is. So I was like in a journey to learn more myself, and I actually also have a hypnosis degree, if you want to know, through all this process. And so while learning about the chakras, it was a friend of mine asked me, oh, do you really believe they exist? And I said, I don't know if they exist. I don't know if all the energy stuff is real, but it makes sense. And for me, it made sense. And I really started knowing more myself through the knowledge about the chakras. So at the yoga studio that she was going, my friend, they were having a course about working, having a yoga class working and healing the chakras. So we were really excited and we wanted to try it out. And the following year we did. And now it's the second year that I'm following that kind of yoga, which is the Kundalini yoga. And it's amazing and I love it. It's one of the practices of yoga that has also a part of meditation in it and also breathing exercises. So I would say the difference between this kind of yoga and some others is that it doesn't only focus on your on your posture, on your physical body, but also in your emotional body. And that's something that I wanted and I needed to work, because I'm a very energetic person and I can lose my focus very easily and distract myself and, you know, be from here to there and there and, you know, be everywhere and nowhere at the same place. So it's something very good for me and it really helped me. So if you're interested about yoga and if I can help you or you want to know something, I'm not an expert, but I will definitely try to help you and give you my advice if you want it. Which are the colors in dyeing that you prefer? Well, I always love more the warmer colors, but What I found out about dyeing is that it's not usually your favorite colors that you usually dye with more. So it's funny because I'm not a very big fan of green, but I see that I love mixturing dyes to have more interesting greens. So yeah, I don't know. There's something about the green that in the dye board really speaks to me. So here we go. Did I learn by myself to dye, or did someone teach you? So I learned by myself, and then I did a course also, but I learned by myself for first. My favorite colors, orange. Rita wants to know, how old are you and when did you start knitting? So, literally how old I am? So, I'm 31 and a half. In July, I will be 32. And I started dyeing, I think, when I was 27 and a half. Something like that. Favorite TV shows, movies? That's a very general, it's like the books, I like many genres. Of course, I love a good Lord of the Rings. But I really, really love The Eternal Sunshine of the Mindless Mind. I adore 500 Days of Summer. I really like also an old film, Willow, which is like a fairy tale. I really like it. I love big old movies like Lawrence of Arabia, A Braveheart. What else? I love French movies also, Jeux d'enfants. I really like, I don't know, there's so many. What about TV shows? Okay, House of Cards. I loved Boardwalk Empire. I love Big Bang Theory because it just reminds me sometimes because I was in the scientific part of my school, and it reminds me a bit, you know, when we were making jokes, me and my friends, with scientific terms. So yeah, I like it. I was also a fan of Grey's Anatomy, but the last season was kind of boring for me. Okay, of course, Game of Thrones, The Sopranos. I love The Sopranos. I also like How to Get Away with Murder. Actually, I haven't seen the last season. I should. And it's also funny because my boyfriend is a fisherman, and I actually kind of enjoy watching Wicked Tuna with him. And it's so funny because I actually, from the girls' woman of the fishing guys, I'm the only one, like, you know, that I'm in the stuff, because I kind of like to hear the stories and all these things. Yeah, so I think that's a spectrum of what I like. What got you interested in fibers and knitting? Well, first of all, it was boredom. I wanted to do something at home on winter days. And then it was, you know, something that I enjoyed to do. But I think first and foremost, I am a dyer. Like, I enjoy more dyeing than knitting. Especially the first year, I didn't have at all a lot of patience with my knitting. So, and sometimes even now, and I'm easily bored and I want just to, you know, finish it or make it faster or whatever, and I will go quickly to another project even if I haven't finished. But now I realize that it's also the combination of the color and the pattern. If the pattern is really speaking to me at the time, and the colors that I've chosen are really speaking to me and are really in my mood, it's gonna be flying. If it's something that I'm not really sure I wanna make, or I wanna change colors all the time, or I want to, you know, I don't know where I'm really going with it, I'm not 100% with it, it's gonna, you know, go very slowly. How many pets do you have? Well, I have a dog. Her name is Dakine. She's a boxer. She's 5 years old and a half, and she's here with me, and she's actually waiting for her to appear. Actually, her ball is outside, so she wants to get away. So that's Dakine. Hi, say hi. Hi, Dakine. She's the cutest. She's awesome. She's great. She never played with my fiber, never with my yarn. Actually, wait a second. She wants to get out. And she's pretty amazing. She's the best. We also have a horse, but it's in the island where we have our summer house. And her name is Lava, and she's also awesome and beautiful. And now the cat is protecting the house from intruders. Favorite place you have traveled to? That's a difficult one, because I love all the places I've been, and I love all the places where there is a sea, and most of the places I go, there's sea. So one of the travels that I enjoyed most was going to San Francisco, but it was for work. But it was a very great experience for me, because I was traveling alone, and it was really, really a crazy experience. But one of my favorite places that I've been is Barcelona and Istanbul. Istanbul, I would say, about some places and history that there is, and Barcelona about the buildings, about the color, about the art. When and why did you start knitting? So I started knitting when I was 27 years old, 28. So it's like four years. And because I was bored and I wanted to find something to do. Favorite stitch, and how many creating hours do you spend? I think my favorite stitch is the stockinette stitch, because it shows better the colors in a variegated yarn, and I love that. I love the little V's going crazy with color. Otherwise, now that I'm knitting continental, because I was the thrower back then at the days, I hated the seed stitch, but now with the continental fashion that I'm knitting, I kind of enjoy the seed stitch, and I really like how it gives another aspect to the knitting. My least favorite thing about dyeing yarn: waiting for it to dry. Like, the drying process sometimes, oh my god. Hopefully I'm gonna get more vans for next winter, because it's really bothering me. Like, sometimes it's drying very nicely, and some other is like, come on baby, please dry, come on. You speak many different languages, but which one do you dream in? Usually people are asking me, in which language do I think? So, and most of the time is, it depends with who am I talking and what, and so it will depend. Like, for example, now I'm speaking in English, so I'm gonna think in English. There's no point on in thinking in Greek and translating my thoughts. So I'm immediately, you know, going English mode. So I guess it's the same thing in my dreams. Like, it will depend with who I am in my dreams or where I am. Yeah, I don't know. How many hours do you spend in your craft? Oh yeah, that's the same question that was before, I'm sorry, but I didn't answer it. So it will depend. One day I might die all day and not need, one other day I might don't do anything. Actually Sunday was like that, because I decided to rest, not die. And then I had to, we went to visit some friends to have lunch, and then there was a yoga festival, so there it goes. I didn't do anything. No, no, nothing, not a stitch. And then yesterday I was dying all day, then I went to my yoga and meditation course, and I needed a bit in the afternoon. Today I have to pack because tomorrow I'm going to the island, but I know that I want to dye around 7 kilos of yarn, so that will be my evening, and then I will knit in front of the TV or something. So it will really depend, and of the mood, and depending how much I have to work on. Do you have a favorite place, and have you considered using it as an inspiration for coloring? I do have favorite places, but for one of them I have an inspiration color, but I'm not sure if I want to share it or if it's something just for me, which is a place when I was a kid and there were pistachio trees, and I like to go up there and stay over there. And the other place is in Paris Island. There's a house, an old house, and when I first went there to visit, it was like I've been already there, I've already lived there, and it was very weird as an experience. But I remember going in the garden and just staying there and feeling like a mix of nostalgia and not understanding why I'm feeling like that, and it was overwhelming. I remember I was overwhelmed. I wanted to stay there forever. Yeah. Who inspired you to want to learn about Greek or Roman mythology, and who inspired you to dye yarn? So I wasn't inspired to learn about Greek mythology, just that I live in Greece, so, and I grew up over here. So it was being around me, and I loved stories, and I liked how people imagined the stories to understand this, their surroundings, because that's what it's about. And for me, who inspired me to dye yarn? Actually, the my friend's mom who learned us to knit yarn. She actually, because I was always complaining about the colors because they were very monochromatic and that I didn't like it, and she always kind of joked around, well, you should dye your own. And then I was like, you know, I kind of dismissed it because I was very, it was very early on my knitting days and I didn't actually know that you can do that. And then after a couple of months when I hit my head, I started searching about it, and then revelation, you can do it. So I just started doing it. So I think maybe it's the first person that actually kind of popped the idea in my mind, even if I didn't truly knew that it was possible to dye yarn. So here is a really interesting question. So there is a terrible disease of some sort that is highly contagious, and everyone in Earth has been exposed. The good news is that scientists have discovered a way to prevent it. They have developed two equally effective and completely safe vaccines. The only difference between them is that each has a side effect. Vaccine A causes people to see from only yellow through violet, so no orange-red. Vaccine B causes people to see only the red through green, no blue and violet. Which vaccines do you choose and why? Come on. Of course I choose B, because I want to see orange. What is it going to be? A word without orange? No. If you were a superhero, which superpower would be yours? So I think that's that question is one of my favorite questions ever. I've thought about it so many times and I think I figure out what I would like to do. Actually, because I'm a very fiery person, I thought for a long time that my superpower would have to do something with fire. But no, people, no. My superpower would be like Mystique from Marvel. Yes, I would like to shift to anybody's appearance. Yeah, I would really love that. It's really interesting and yeah. And you could learn so much things. Yeah, I would be totally into that. How did you learn how to knit? Well, it was because I was bored after summer and I wanted to learn something, and me and a friend of mine, we convinced her mom and she told us. What was the first knitting project you ever made and how did it turn out? So my first project was a beanie for my niece, my baby niece, and I was knitting so tightly that it was so small it didn't fit. So I knitted it for nothing, but it was fun. Favorite book, quote, passage, and why? This question's from CJ. Hi, CJ. So my favorite book, if I had to choose one, would have been Women Who Run With the Wolves. I really love it. And if I had to pick a passage, it would be all the book. Like, literally. I'm sure if I open up the book someplace, I would find something that is truly interesting. Yeah, and actually I did, but if I start reading it, it's not gonna make much sense with what all I've been saying. But I really love it. Yeah, now I'm actually opened it in another page, but it's saying about death and it's gonna be a bit morbid, but it's amazing. It's really, really cool. Like for example, now there's a passage now over here that it says you can call it anything you like, but sneaking on life because the real one is not given room enough to thrive is hard on a woman's vitality. Captured and starved women sneak all kinds of things. They sneak unsanctioned books and music. They sneak friendships, sexual feeling, religious affiliation. They sneak furtive thinking, dreams of revolution. They sneak time away from their mates and families. They sneak a treasure into the house. They sneak their writing time, their thinking time, their soul time. They sneak a spirit into the bedroom, a poem before work. They sneak a skip or an embrace when no one's looking. So, yeah, that's when she talks about a woman who's not, you know, really letting herself being in the creative process that she wants, either because she has forsake her creativity, or if she's not allowed by others her creativity. So it's really nice. I really love it. I really love it. I go and buy it. It's not an expensive book also, so there's no excuse. Where was I? How do you decide on your exclusive colorways for shops and stores? Well, that's a process that we're going through the shop. It depends what they are searching for at the time, or if they have an inspiration theme as a shop, or it depends. Or if I have something to suggest, or if they like a colorway that I have, but with a twist. So it will really depend. Do you have another job? I am a trend optometrist. I was actually working full time as an optometrist until last September, and I gave up my job because my fiber business is going very well. And for the last year, I was working full time both of them, and I just couldn't do it anymore. I was always tired. I got sick because I was tired. So I had to decide which one I wanted to pursue. And I chose the fibery business. And even though I have big ups and downs, it's not easy for me. But, and I think it's never gonna be really easy. And I don't want it to be, easy, but you know what I mean. There are a few times that I kind of struggle, but I find it much more creative and much more into my real true vocation because I've always been between science and color and artistic, and it's somewhere where I can be both. I can be with color, I can be with chemistry, and I love that. Where is your favorite place to be? Wherever there's sea. So simple. Have you ever thought of creating one project using all your colorways? Yes, of course I have, but it's gonna be a big project, a blanket or something, and I'm just not into that for the moment. But I would love to do that at some point. What color do you gravitate more for knitting, crochet, fiber, fun? I would say more into the warm spectrum of the color wheel, but I love a good blue, teal, or an emerald, so a bit of all, but more bright colors. One single favorite color. Orange, people, orange. Favorite book. Women Who Run with the Wolves Again. Which music do you prefer to dye or knit? So, I want something cheerful, and it usually will be with compilations or playlists from decades like 80s, 70s, and so I can hear some tunes that I like, and I can sing along, and move a bit my body. Yeah. My favorite season, summertime. Next projects for this year. I know I wanted to do the Starburst. Is it Starburst or Stardust? Starburst, I think, from Stephen West. I want to do some color working. I'm gonna go in May in Holland, and I'm gonna get the Shetlandic sweater book, and I love the book that the book. I love the pattern that is in the book. I also have some mitts with color work, so I think I'm gonna start with them so I can get accustomed a bit to the color working knitting. I also want to do the Granito sweater from Joji Locatelli, and there's another one in her interpretation 4, which has some stripes over here. What else? I wanted just more socks also, which is weird for me. It's new, the sock addiction. But it's a smaller project and it gives you the satisfaction that you finish something. And I need to make some mitts because I don't have mitts, but I'm procrastinating because I hate doing things twice. So maybe I will cast on two at a time mitts. Can I do that? I'm not even sure, but I will try. In the French language, which is your verb that you prefer? I'm usually, when I'm freaking out or there's too much going on, I'm usually saying je pète les plombs. Donc, je pète les plombs, it's like I'm freaking out, it's too much. But the verb is like I'm farting the plomb. I'm farting, I don't know what. It's something like iron or metal. There was actually a French song, like a rap song or whatever, when I was young. When I was young, like I'm not old, like, but when I was 16, for example, and it was saying, je pète les plombs, putain, je pète les plombs. Donc, I don't know. It's like sometimes when I wanna, I'm freaking out, but I'm laughing also with the situation. Like, I like to say that. And so it's like I'm farting unicorn rainbows. So yeah, je pète, je pète, je Okay. Who's your favorite musical artist? Oh gosh. I've never had a teenage crush on an artist, but there was a crisis at some point with Depeche Mode. I loved everything they did. I went to three concerts in France, in England, here, and I love their songs. I also been a kid that I grew up with George Michael, Michael Jackson, Madonna, like, all those great big icons, and I love them all. I'm also the kind of girl who likes John Secada, who likes to listen to Alanis Morissette, who likes also a nice shake with Ricky Martin. I love R&B also. I love so much of music. Like, I'm a very acoustic person, so I really like a good tune. Like, even if it's classical music, I love Tchaikovsky, Chopin. I love the Braveheart theme. Elvis Presley. You see, I kind of love everything. Simply Red, Carlos Santana, I don't think I really have one favorite. You can just have one favorite. Favorite sock patterns, like, okay, I've done three pairs of socks. The first was the Fergus sock pattern, which I loved, but I did, one sock at a time. So I had the syndrome of the second sock totally 100%. So it took me like 4 months after to finish the second sock. Yeah. And then I asked Cecile in France to show me how to do them both at a time. So I did some vanilla socks with an afterthought heel. And it went terrific, amazing. And now I did the Fraser Fair sock. It's like a vanilla sock, but in the leg part, there's like a little chart, very small, very nice. And I like them both. So I'm very lucky because, and the three patterns that I did were amazingly explained, very, very easy. But on the 2 second ones that I did two at a time, I did 60 stitches, and the one I knitted with 250 millimeters and the second with 225. But they're still a bit large in the cuff. So I'm thinking on doing 56 stitches now. with 2.5 millimeter, I think it's gonna hold better. And because yeah, those that I have, they're really nice. I really like them, but they're kind of sliding on my feet, and I really like a good fit on my socks. So I'll try to move it down for 56 stitches, and we'll see. But I'm sorry, I don't have a lot of experience with socks, but I'm thinking of doing an apple blossom, I think, or something like that. I'm not sure about the how it's called. And also, I want to try to knit definitely Mina's, the Knitting Expat sock patterns, because she had a collection for beginners, and I think it's a nice thing. And I'm trying, you know, to learn a more specific way to do them, but just one thing at a time, like a new technique. So I think I'm gonna try that. Favorite color? Orange, people. Favorite candy? Ice cream. It's not a candy, but ice cream. Otherwise, I really love everything that's Haribo. Oh, my favorite Haribo is the spaghetti Haribo, and it's those little like spaghettis, pink and has sugar, but it's very sour. And when you eat them, you're like, I love those. Do you have pets? Yes, a dog, the kind. Tell us about your horse. What breed is she or he? Do you ride a lot? So, the horse that we have is in our summer house. Her name is Lava. She's a race horse, retired horse. Actually, we save her from going into our meal. And she's just retired. We don't really ride her. I just take her for walks and just hang out with her. I used to ride a lot, but not so much now, but I would love to ride more. Do you have a garden, and what is your favorite flower? Well, one year we are back in the city, we don't have a garden yet, and I really miss it. I'm a kind of person that really needs to be with nature all around her, so I really miss a garden. So half of the year we don't have a garden. Unfortunately, my favorite flower is irises, I would say. Yeah, purple with yellow. It's funny because I didn't pick an orange flower, you see. Pets, do you have pets, and a bit about your daily life? So I have the kine and a horse in our summer house. And what my daily life? Well, my daily life changes every day, so it will depend on what do I need to dye, what do I need to do for my marketing biz, what do I do for replying to customers, emails and stuff, pre-orders, orders, contacting with Liz, Skype meetings, FaceTime meetings. So every day is a different day. The only thing that is on my schedule is my meditation and yoga practice on Mondays, and I try to do some every day in the morning, and that's it. Yeah, and it's kind of difficult for me not to have like a program or an approximate program, but I'm much better than in the beginning, because in the beginning I was completely freaking out working from home. I still do, but not so much. So I hope that that I will have a dyeing studio soon, that I could be able to afford that. Which brand of mythology do you prefer? Greek, Roman, Nordic, Native American? Well, I surely do feel that I know more about the Greeks and the Romans and the Egyptians, because just that what was more near to me and what was like more natural for me to learn when I was a kid. But I'm very interested also in the Native and Nordic mythology. I don't know them that much, but I like when I see similarities, like you know, when I read a story and then I'm, oh, Oh, that's the same, kind of relate with this one in the Greek. So I can be a bit geeky about that, but yeah, not so much. Band-aid ripper or a band-aid picker? So I would definitely say that I was a band-aid ripper, but now I'm neither of them, because when you've been in the medicinal world, there's a way. So if you have a band-aid or something, scotched in your on your skin, just take a cotton pad and put some alcohol and rub it over there where there's the glue, and the alcohol will, take away most of the glue, and then it's gonna be much more easier, and it's gonna be painful, but much less than if you had to rip it like that. Oh, and the girl who did the woman who did this question, she said, "Oh, I can understand a lot of things about and when you someone answers that question, so I wonder what's my answer says about my personality." What is your favorite non-knitting podcast? So I recently started listening to some other podcasts that are not knitting related, and so I don't really have a very good, just to say, oh, my favorite is this one and this one and this one, but I have two or three about yoga and mindfulness. And I have one that I actually enjoyed. At first, I was thinking that I might be scary a bit, but it's called My Favorite Murder. And it's really cool. It's actually two women, and they're talking about murders and what happened, and they discuss about it, and it's kind of very interesting. And last question, and it's kind of fitting that it's the last one. What childhood dream is still on your mind? Well, working wise, my dream was to be either a vet or a painter. I guess I'm in a way a painter, and I'm in a way a vet because I'm the doctor about all our animals, and especially after last summer that I had to give shots in our horse, not Lava, the other horse that we had, and he had a really bad temper, and when I think about it, it's like, oh my God, I gave him shots every day. That was crazy. Yeah. I wonder how come he didn't kick me or, worse. But yeah. So I'm pretty happy about those dreams. Another dream is that I want to travel the world. And yeah. I think I'm not doing bad so far, but I want more. When traveling involved, I want more. I know it's not gonna be enough. Even like I almost did like four or five travels this year so far with work, and I'm gonna have at least other three or four travels this year until the end of the year. It's not enough. I'm not happy. Yeah, I want to travel. I think that's where my greediness goes. It's not on yarn, it's not on money, it's not on acquisitions, but I'm very greedy traveler. Yeah, I want to travel all the time. Yes. Maybe that's some of my nomadic genes because I have Tuareg blood in me, I think also. Yeah. Have so much blood from everywhere, so I'm sure there's a nomadic blood gene over there somewhere. So that was it. Thank you for all your questions, and now's the time to reveal who won. Okay, so we have two winners, and I will contact you when this video podcast is up in the air. And so the first winner who wins two skeins of my Zeus yarn base, which is the single superwash merino fingering weight, is Stone Knits. So Charlotte, I'm so happy it's you who won the first lot. So I'm gonna be in contact with you. And the second winner is Riza Knits. You won with the question asking me my age. That's crazy. Come on, I'm just kidding. So I'm really, really excited that you're both winners. You both win two skeins of Zeus in the colorways you choose. So that's amazing. So thank you for watching. If it was your first time, I hope I didn't bore you with all the stuff talking about me, and I hope you don't think I'm a selfish little who talks all about me. But I thought it was a nice idea, you know, for you to get to know me better. And if you have any other questions, I will try and pop them up in the next podcast. So thank you for watching. If you want to see the new colorways that I'm gonna have, I think either tomorrow or after tomorrow, there's gonna be pre-orders. Pre-orders are going to be open now, like all the time, but you'll have to give me 10 to 15 minutes, days to do them. And then you'll have them, and I'm very happy and excited because there's not only new colorways but new yarn bases also, and I can wait for your feedback with all that. So thank you guys for watching. Be sure to follow me also on Instagram, and if you like what you see, please subscribe. Have a nice day. Bye bye.